It's a pleasure to be among you, and thank you for turning up on a dark and gloomy evening. But I think the skies are clearing up, which means we have some good signs. But first of all, I'd like to extend an invitation to you. As you know, that this book has just been published, and next week on the 18th in Delhi, it's going to be released by Shashi Tharoor, and Gurcharan Das and Shireen Ban from CNBC, and I will be talking post the release. And if you're in Delhi on the 18th, please come to this event. It's at the India International Center. The book has actually been a kind of a journey, and what I want to talk to you about is this journey of how I, as a hardcore electrical engineer, then a true double master's degrees in computer science, artificial intelligence and robotics, and then distributed computing, very, very hardcore operations management at Wharton, very quantitative stuff, how did I come make this transition to talking about something called leadership, right? And something that's much more in the realm of humanities, which is why for me, Manthan is a very nice platform on which to talk here, that it brings together both the hard and the soft sciences in some sense, right? Let me go on to the presentation. So one of the key things that happens, and I don't know if the slides will become start to become clear as we go along. So the topic today is leading in turbulent times, how intelligences make the difference. And for those of you who are not familiar with the title of the book, the word intelligences is not misspelt. It is deliberately used in the plural. And I'm going to explain why that is the case here. Firstly, just to backtrack a bit, I just finished my PhD at Wharton, and I was my first faculty position was in Purdue University, which, as you know, is a very tech school. But I was teaching in the business school there, and again, talking a little much more technology. So my focus has always been on why do companies invest in information technology? Why is technology important? Can you see any economic value from investing in technology? And in the 90s, there was this big debate about whether IT actually improves the productivity of a company. And my PhD focused on that. So when I moved into a faculty position, I was still looking for this. Is there any value to bringing information technology into the world? And this, of course, the late 90s was when e-commerce, as we know it today, was in its boom. Okay, so many business models were coming up. Yahoo had just established itself as a big player. Nobody knew which would succeed, which would fail. A lot of IPOs were being issued. Companies were going public and then going bankrupt. So it was a crazy kind of thing. But the fact is that today, too, it's a very crazy world. That when you look at it, in the business world, you'll see all kinds of stuff happening. Technology is no longer stable. It's transient. There are people moving across organizations, and there's tremendous job uncertainties. And there are so as a project manager in an IT organization, for instance, you won't know whether your employees will be with you next month or not. And how do you plan amidst this uncertainty? So one basic question that started this and has driven the research is how do you create strategy when the world is very uncertain? That there is a tremendous kind of, it's an oxymoronic statement in some sense that you're planning for 2-3 years down the road when next week could be uncertain. Right, so how do you handle this? And this actually, some lessons came out to me as I started exploring this, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. That the journey toward this book actually took me to some very important lessons. Typically, how do we react to uncertainty? Okay. And the joke here is, I think many of you might have heard of the two hikers and the bear joke. Two hikers are hiking across a vast meadow, and there's no tree, nothing in sight, and suddenly they see a bear in the distance coming toward them pretty, aggressively. So then they start running. And one of the guys suddenly stops, and he starts to unpack his knapsack. And the other guy says, "What are you doing?" So he says, "I'm changing my shoes into my hiking boots into my shoes, canvas shoes, so I can run faster, my sneakers." So I said, "Are you crazy? The bear is right here." And this guy turns and says, "You know what? I don't need to run faster than the bear. I need to run faster than you," right? So this is the kind of stuff that we're engaged in. That in the effort to cope with uncertainty, we take very short-term solutions. Okay? And this is a metaphor that goes on in whether it's an organization or whether it's our personal lives. That when we're faced with uncertainty, we seem to be grabbing the very first kind of solution that appears to us, whether or not that may be the optimal one in the long run. So how do we then create any kind of strategy or any kind of method by which we can handle uncertainty in the long run? Okay, so that's the thrust of this. And you know, some lessons that came to me as I was working on this is this, that first, when there is this turbulence that we are talking about, it's not at the it's not just at the business level. That turbulence enters our world, you know, in the everyday life, right? So the turbulence of business environments is actually creeping into this. What the hell does it matter if WhatsApp is being bought over by Facebook? Makes a tremendous difference to the, you know, the things that affect us, right? So ultimately what's happening is that these technological changes, these kind of business kinds of decisions that are being made flow over into our own lives and affect us tremendously. So how do we actually create this? This is one big lesson, that turbulence, very easy for us to say the turbulence is seen by the business world, but actually the turbulence spills over into our everyday life. Yes, so that's one lesson that I learned here. Second, when we think about the organization itself, we have a sense of partitioning things. So strategy is usually in the corporate boardroom. Leadership is handled by the HR people. And innovation is mostly in the R&D and operations kind of thing. And what this is telling me actually is that, really speaking, these are very tightly integrated. It is very much like, you know, if you look at William Butler Yeats's poem, how can you tell the dancer from the dance? If you're watching a dance performance, and I ask you the question, are you watching the dance or the dancer? There will not be an adequate response. That's what's happening here. Are you watching the strategist or are you watching strategy? Right? So now when you start thinking about the strategist, we're going to talk about leadership. When we talk about the strategy, we might talk about innovation and perhaps, you know, some amount of strategy. So this is one lesson. So I'm actually going to lay out some of these lessons as a backgrounder to what I'm going to discuss. But these are things that came to me as I was engaging in this research. Second, so this is the second lesson. Lesson number three is this, that leadership is actually an everyday phenomenon. And if you think about it, who is not a leader? Right? Who is not a leader? Because as a parent, I'm a leader to my children. As a sibling, I'm a leader to my siblings. As a child, maybe sometime as I become older, I'm nowadays actually a leader to my parents too. As a teacher, as teachers, we are leaders. So, and some friends, consultants, we are leaders. So the notion of leadership has become very diffuse now. That it is not a question of just position or power that gives you leadership, that willy-nilly you are a leader in life. So the question really is not whether you are a leader or not, but whether you are a good leader or not, especially given that the situation is dynamic and unfolding, right? So here, let me tell you a quick story here. Two anthropologists were working in Chicago, and they were talking to the owner of a kitchen, usually a cookhouse, that's pretty large size kitchen. And the old person, 65, 70-year-old woman who was talking to them, was asked, you know, what drives your everyday mentality in your kitchen? You're running a very efficient operation for so long, a pretty good operation, so how are you managing? And she told them a story, which we call the broken cup story. She told them, when I was about five, I was helping my mother wash dishes in the kitchen. All of a sudden, a cup, you know, fell out of my hand and broke on the floor. My mother didn't say a word. She picked up another cup and dropped it on the floor. And it broke. And we silently swept up the pieces. Now, why is she telling you this as a management story? This kind of thing has left such an impact that she uses it in her daily life to talk about failure, to think about how to handle somebody else's failure, how to be forgiving, how to think of mistakes and recovery from mistakes. So how do we develop that kind of wherewithal with which we can handle a broken cup story? This is the kind of stuff that we need to think about here. So that is why I call this very much a everyday leadership problem. The fourth lesson that I got is that leadership is collective. How many here have seen Finding Nemo? Movie? Yes. So I was watching it with my six-year-old. And at the end of the movie, there is this scene where the fish swim in a very coordinated fashion and they pull down the net and break it. Right? And so, of course, I had to research this. So I went there and looked up whether this was actually possible. And when you look at the ocean life systems, this is a not very clear, but this is a huge school of fish that's in the South Pacific. And these schools of fish, so you can see tiny fish grouped together in one big group of fish. Now, what happens here is that this group of fish is swimming collectively through the sea. When they see a marauder, some kind of a shark or a whale, what they do is they form this big circle and swim rapidly around that. And when they swim rapidly, the predator gets scared and goes away. But that's the war time. Let's call it war time. Peace time, they're going through the sea. All the food is coming from the front, right? So if by the time it reaches the third or the fourth layer, the food is over. So what do the fish at the back do? So there is an automatic rotation of leadership that happens. The fish switch positions. Same thing on the sides of the fish, of this huge school of fish. They are the guards. They're watching out for all the predators. But you can't be on guard duty all the time. So you get tired. So there is an automatic switching of position. And this is very, very common. And we've, of course, not noticed this. But it's a very common thing in biological systems, whether you think of a flock of birds flying and maintaining that V pattern in the sky, or a school of fish flowing through the waters. And how do we then become think about leadership as being collective, whether in an organization or in a country? The fourth lesson is that leadership is very context sensitive. And here I have an example from history. In May 1945, World War II ended. And a month later, the British parliamentary elections were held. At that time, Winston Churchill, who had just won the war, right, for Britain, was the most popular prime minister in the history of England. No prime minister before him had this kind of 83% favorability ratings. When the elections were held, though, those of you who know history know that he failed miserably, in fact, in the election, so bad that he took an exile for some time after that. So this has been a leadership conundrum. Why is it that such a popular prime minister lost elections, and that too so badly? And people have talked about various things, but then one of the things that has come up, and leadership experts agree on this, is that what Winston Churchill was perceived as was a tremendous wartime leader, but not a good peacetime leader. And so this led a very famous scholar called Warren Bennis, who's at the University of Southern California, who is noted and recently passed away in early 2015. He commented in one of his final works, just after 50, 60 years of studying leadership. He says that if you were to come and ask me what is the one competence that we need as leaders, it's this thing called adaptive capacity, right? So the notion of adapting is very, very essential to leadership. And that's what my talk is going to be about. Okay? Now, very interestingly, there are some spillovers here. When you think about how does an organization handle turbulence and change, here's one of the most successful British CEOs, Lord John Brown, who headed BP and made it the worldwide thing that it is today. He says that when you see change, given the kind of change that we're seeing today, all you can do is give yourself the capacity to respond to the answer, to the certainty in life, which is uncertainty. Okay? So now you're talking not so much about, from a strategic perspective, you're not talking so much about developing a plan of actions, but developing capabilities, whether it is within the organization or whether it is within the individual. Okay? So a pointer comes to us from here. And the pointer is, if I was to think about, this, go back to the dancer and the dance, metaphor. Let's say, if I want to think about a leader, and especially in turbulent times, how would I handle something where I'm just dropped in and there's no way I have any kind of resource? Okay? So let's say I don't know a city, and I'm dropped in that city, and I'm told to find my way from point A to point B. How would I do it? Right? And then the question comes up that actually we've been doing this for ages now, for millions, for thousands of years we've done this. And I'm going to give you an example from North America. In fact, the history of human evolution. So paleontologists today believe that the first humans entered North America through Alaska, crossing over from Russia into Alaska, across a small strip of sea that's called the Bering Strait. It's a shallow kind of sea there, very narrow strip of sea. And it is believed that at one time, maybe it had iced over or it was much more shallow, that they could actually swim or boat over, and they came over into North America. And 10,000 years ago is when this happened, and that's not too much in evolutionary history. So you can see that from a BBC reconstruction, they're very much like us, like you and me. Not much change in evolutionary patterns from then and here, then and now. So they have to clothe themselves. They don't have hairy skin. They don't have any kind of Neanderthal skulls, etc. They're very much like you and me. Now, when they came into the North American continent, what did they encounter? These are the first humans coming into North American continent. These are the animals. Okay, of course, Ice Age made them very romantic for us, the movie Ice Age. But basically, you had these huge woolly mammoths, right? And that was what they had to hunt for food. And these guys were very puny, like you and me. And worse, they had to contend with wild saber-toothed tigers. And the saber-toothed tiger was a specially ferocious animal. It was about 1.5 times the present tiger's size, had very powerful forearms, and it had 2 9-inch long stiletto-like teeth. So you would the animal would trap its prey by pinning them down with the forearms and go straight for the jugular. So death was painless, perhaps, but definite, right? If you were attacked by a saber-toothed tiger, death was painless, but definite. So how, if you fast forward 10,000 years? There are no woolly mammoths, there are no saber-toothed tigers, but there are people. So what accounts? When people don't have those resources, physical resources of these animals, how is it that they have survived? And what has emerged very interestingly is that people now begin to realize that this actually has, it can be traced back to how they actually use their intelligence. They shaped, I'm okay, can you see this? That's So the question is, what did these people do? And now fossilized remains tell us that these people were very fantastic in their minds. What they did was they fashioned stone and metal into very sharp spearheads, which were actually had something called flutes on the side. So it was very aerodynamic. They attached them to sticks and shafts, and that became spears and, arrows. They learned how to hunt in teams. So one team would go in there into a ravine and attract or draw in woolly mammoths, and other people would throw stones from the top, and that would serve for a week of meat for the entire group. So this kind of stuff, now what drives this? And the idea is that basically when you think about it, it's the species name that we have that gives us a hint, which is Homo sapiens. And sapiens, of course, is connected with intelligence. So this, till now what had been happening was I was approaching this whole problem of how to handle uncertainty in the business world from a very mathematical microeconomist economist perspective. And suddenly when I moved to University of Minnesota and started looking at more behavioral, because the school is very behaviorally oriented, suddenly new things started to open up. So still the IQ stuff is very interesting for me, so the intelligence stuff is very interesting to me, because now I have a number actually I thought I could pin to this. So can I take the same concept to organizations and say, this organization is more intelligent than another organization, so it is more adaptable than another organization. So then my eyes lit up, because now I can say, hey, this has an IQ measure that's more than another. And I found that it was actually, I was maybe about 20 years behind the curve here, because psychologists had left IQ behind. Intelligence researchers had left IQ behind and gone, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But before I do that, here's a definition for intelligence today. The current definition for intelligence. It says, intelligence is the ability to adapt to an environment, to reshape an environment or to choose a new environment. And it is also the ability to say which of these three actions is good for me to do right now. So to give you an example, I'm in a room and I find it very hot. What do I do to adapt to an environment? I adapt to the environment by maybe taking off my, you know, jacket. So I'm adapting to the environment because it's too hot. So otherwise, if I reshape an environment, maybe I want to turn on the AC, right? I reshape the environment. A third one would be I do neither but walk out of the room and find a cooler spot. So these are three different actions, and they have very interesting management underpinnings, because each of these gives us a different kind of strategy. And I won't go into that, but basically just to mention that this is a certain kind of adapting to an environment is basically something called Porter's positioning. So there is Michael Porter, who came out of Harvard and with this theory called five forces. And he said that there are five different forces that are affecting every organization, and these forces change. So the challenge of strategy is to think about how do we position a company so that it is least affected by these five forces. So that's the adapting to an environment. And most of you might have heard of C.K. Prahlad, the Indian management guru, who came out with this concept called core competence, where the argument is that you need to find something that's really, really essential to you, and how do you use that to reshape the environment. And the third one is something that's buzzword today in organizations, which is called blue ocean strategy, where you say, you know what, I'm going to ignore the competition and going to find a very new space to operate in. And that's the blue. So now, with intelligence, with the older methodologies, we'd get locked into one of these. But with intelligence, suddenly, we can keep shifting back and forth between these methodologies. So what is strategic agility? Now, putting all this together, there is on the one hand, we're using intelligence to cope with uncertainty. And on the other hand, we're trying to think about creating a strategy. Right? So when we put that, we say, actually, now we start to think about two different aspects. There is one, the individual. Like I said, you can't distinguish the dancer from the dance. So you need to think about the dancer. And here's the dance. So what are the processes within the organization? What are the technologies within the organization that you will need? But my focus today will be to talk about how do we use this to become better leaders. As I said, willy-nilly, we are leaders in everyday life. How do we use this to become better leaders in our everyday lives? Now, why am I using the word intelligences and not intelligence? Why am I using it in the plural? So I'm going to give you a small task here, and I'll take a voice vote here. I'm going to ask you a question. I don't need the exact answer, but I'm more interested in the process by which you would solve this. So here's a question. How would you find out the distance from your home to your favorite movie theater? Any responses? Google Maps, fantastic. Sorry? Past experience, okay. So drive and see, fantastic.
Traveling time,
so you do a mathematical computation, right?
By counting the steps.
Okay. Phone and find out, ask somebody, right? Anything else? There's another solution, right? Which you can say, you know what? I don't know the distance to the theater, but I know the distance to the market, which is on the other side. And it's about the same time it takes me to drive there. So I do this transposition, right? I take this knowledge that I have from one domain and put it in another domain. Now, what is this? Actually, you can think about this. That you can math and math formula and look up something on the internet, or use past experience to come up with this. So I don't do any kind of, and I don't move from my armchair virtually, right? That's one kind of thing. The other one is jump into my car and drive there, or walk there, count the number of steps. You know, this is a one kind of solution. The other is the parallel to the other to another place, and the fourth one is asking and calling and asking a friend. Now, none of these is more superior to the other. It all depends on context. If you have somebody who's sitting right beside you who knows this distance, there's no point you're jumping into a car and driving there when this person can answer that, right? So it is very context dependent, and as a result, it now comes down to five leadership intelligences. Analytical is where you're actually using a math formula, looking up a Google Maps thing, or using your past experience to come up with a solution to the problem. Operational is when you're jumping into action, driving in there and counting, looking at the odometer, or running there and counting the number of steps. Communicative is where you ask people. And the fourth one is inventive. Now I said five, they're missing a fifth. Now this was my framework for a long time. And I was actually very heady with this because suddenly I wasn't going to be a consultant, I was a business school professor. But suddenly L'Oreal found my research somewhere on the net. And they came and said, you know what, we're flying 23 of our country directors to Stanford, to California actually, to look at Apple as a company that does great innovation. We'd like them to be exposed to some of the latest thinking in innovation and strategy. Could you please come and do a workshop for them at Stanford? Great, very heady for a young assistant professor. It's about 10 years ago. So I flew there, did this workshop, and that's when the consulting bug caught, right? I started the whole consulting. So for about two, three years after I started this, I was going around saying that this is the model for intelligences, right? This is the model for agilities. And I had very good examples, you know, so lots of companies that were successful by this. But suddenly I had to do a rethink. Two companies which I had modeled as being exemplars of using this suddenly collapsed. One was Enron in the US. We taught case after case in every management school about how Enron was doing fantastic innovation, how it was doing that and this, and suddenly it collapsed. And another company, I had come to Hyderabad actually to give lots of leadership lessons there, talks about, you know, strategy here. And suddenly that too went up overnight. And that was, yes, Satyam, right? So I had to go back to the drawing board saying, hey, there's something missing here. In my framework, there's something missing. It doesn't seem to be answering some of the basic questions that these companies are not able to survive. Maybe there's a short-term response, but what about the long-term response? And it's very easy to jump and say these were ethical disturbances, right? So I first thought of, oh, there must be some intelligence that's connected with ethics. But then as I thought about it, it's not just ethics, because an example popped up, and that is the Green Revolution, where there's not an issue of ethics. But those of you who don't know the Green Revolution started as a response to a world hunger crisis in the 60s. The world was almost on the verge of not having enough food for the people. It was consuming much more than it produced. So how do you actually make more food was a question. How do you grow more crops? How do you get more wheat? So a bunch of researchers in the US started working in Mexico and found that there were certain agricultural practices which would actually boost agricultural production. And they brought it, of course, to Punjab, where there was a, you know, dire need for this. And especially because they were working with wheat, they brought it to Punjab. And they looked at the Punjab farmer. And they said, you know what, the Punjab farmer is a fool because he doesn't sow the full year. He only plants half the year. He doesn't use groundwater. He uses only open wells and irrigation from rivers and is monsoon dependent. He doesn't use any fertilizers. He doesn't plant any cash crops. So these are some of the issues they brought up, and they suddenly transformed Punjab through the Green Revolution. So now the Punjab farmer was growing all year round. He was tapping into groundwater, he was using fertilizers, he was using hybrid seeds. All these things contributed to Punjab becoming tremendously green over the next 10 years. It became the granary of India, one of the most wealthiest states of India, right? But what happens? You go forward, and you start finding, the Punjab farmer starts to find that the 100-foot borewell that he had is not yielding any water. It needs to go to 200 feet. That's not yielding any water. Go to 500 feet. Not even that, 1,000 feet. Now, as he goes deeper and deeper, the pump sets become more and more expensive. He has to pump more. Electricity becomes more expensive. As a result, suddenly he's faced with debt. And go back to the old conundrum that we had. The farmer is born in debt, lives in debt, and dies in debt. And now you see there's lots of suicides in Punjab. So there was nothing about ethics here. Green Revolution scientists were very ethical. They had the good of the world in mind, but they didn't have that long-term vision. So which is why we call that the visionary intelligence, which is all these propose some kind of solutions, which may be short-term, but what the visionary sits and does is ask questions about the long-term. How is this going to play out in the long-term? How many people is it going to affect? In what ways is it going to affect? So what is the width of the vision? What is the depth of the vision? That is why we call it the visionary intelligence. So here's a graphic basically to explain that. The five intelligences, analytical intelligences, what analytical intelligence does, it either uses analysis or it says, let's not solve this problem again and again. We've solved it in the past, like you said, experience. Use your past experience and just apply it. That's analytical intelligence. I have to make a distinction here between intelligence or agility and analytical ability. If I was to ask you, how do you do 2 times 3? What is the answer to 2 times 3? Right? You'd immediately say 6. Now that's ability. What is agility? Agility is, how can you do 2 times 3 in multiple ways? Can you do it in many ways than one? Right? You can think of it as counting 2 3 times. Right? So repeated counting, repeated addition is multiplication. Or you can draw 2 lines and intersect 3 lines and say the intersections are 6. So I count intersections as multiplication. So multiplication can now be seen in different ways. So that is what we mean by agility. That it is not a question of are you able to solve the problem in one way. That is ability. Are you able to solve the problem in multiple ways? And depending on context, are you able to shift between these multiple ways? So that is analytical agility. Operational is very clear. Basically, you solve problems by getting into action. And this is typically seen by leaders who lead from the front, who lead by example. So a general jumping in front of his troops and actually leading his troops. And a classic example of that is Napoleon, who slept with his troops by the cannons. And that inspired his soldiers a lot. And there's tremendous loyalty towards Napoleon. Inventive intelligence, it's not very clear here. But inventive intelligence is the one that we often associate with inventive stuff, right? Solutions are not known in this. How do I solve this problem? So one of the characteristics that happens in inventive intelligence is the ability to take a solution that works in some other domain and bring it to this problem domain. And I'll give you some examples and stories of this. The fourth intelligence is communicative intelligence, where you find that you need to persuade, you need to motivate, you need to actually lead by communicating. And this is one of the classic things that's happening with the Nestle and Maggie kind of crisis here today. That there is a tremendous kind of communication intelligence required on the part of Nestle, and it's not doing that very well, not handling that part very well. The fifth one I've talked about, visionary intelligence. So all these propose some solutions, but visionary intelligence has to veto that, has to say this is the right thing to do or this is not the right thing to do. So you will hear, when you talk about innovation in India, you hear a lot about Jugaad, right? We're all familiar with the word Jugaad, right? Where Jugaad is a short-term response, a very quick kind of response. A tractor driver finds that his radiator is leaking, so he takes a lump of wood and sticks it to block the radiator from leaking. Now, very effective short-term solution, but won't work in the long term, right? So the difference between Jugaad and innovation as such is made by visionary intelligence. But you can see this playing out in every context as we think about leadership. One of the key characteristics is that leaders have all five intelligences and they apply them in context sensitive way. A useful metaphor here would be to think of the four leadership intelligences, analytical, operational, inventive, and communicative, as primary colors. So if I want to paint, bring out some color, I will mix these in different proportions. So I want to get purple, what I will do is mix red and blue, right? So the primary colors are mixed in these proportions, and then the medium with which we mix that is visionary intelligence. So that's a useful metaphor to think. But different colors will need us to mix them in different proportions. So that's what happens in every situation. There will be some amount of intelligence that's called for, of different proportions. How do we recognize those five different, how do we recognize the proportions and apply them? Yeah. I'm going to give you a story here of how a very effective leader used this, the five intelligences. Yeah. And the story goes back to 1987, the world was struggling to solve a problem that was facing several African communities. And it was a problem called river blindness. along rivers in Africa, certain rivers in Africa, entire communities would go blind. They were going blind. So kids would be, babies would be born okay. As they grew older, they would start to lose eyesight, and by the time they were young adults, they're completely blind. Scientists had traced it to some, some bacteria, but they didn't know how to attack that. There was no antibiotic for that. So at this time, Roy Vagelos was the CEO of Merck. And as every pharmaceutical company was struggling with this problem, his discovery scientists came to him and said, you know what, we have a miracle cure for this. We are the only ones in the world who can solve this. And not only that, it's cost us the pittance to take this from the lab to production. Only $2 million to take it to commercialization. Not only that, even to supply year after year, it's only going to cost us $20 million. This is really, paltry sums for a huge researcher, a huge pharmaceutical giant, and especially in the medicine field, right? What could be the problem? So here's, there's a tremendous market waiting, entire communities waiting for this drug. We are the only ones who have this drug. Not only that, our costs to make this drug are so low that we can actually command a high price and make tremendous profits here. So what's the problem? What could be a problem? Poor communities. These guys couldn't even afford that particular drug, even though it was cheap, right? Even if you made it available for cheap, it was very, very poor. So now, what I want to give with this context, with this story, is that as you apply your intelligences to solve a particular situation, the kind of intelligence that you will need will keep changing. So here you see that it was an unknown problem that you were trying to solve, so you needed inventive intelligence, that you needed to have much more of the inventive intelligence. But as things progressed, suddenly the problem got transformed to being something that you will now have to handle. How do you do some kind of, how do you provide this drug to people who need it? So what did Vagelos do? Vagelos pursued many things. Yeah? One of the things he did was he went and asked for funding from the government. And the USAID, of course, threw up its arm and said, we have no funds. So what does he do next? He goes to WHO. And the World Health Organization again says the same thing, but not only does it say the same thing, it puts a moral issue here. And it says, you know what, you're a fat, rich American company, you should be giving this drug away for free. Right? Morally justified. And so Vagelos actually says, yeah, this is a good solution. But despite his sensitivity, he is now working in a corporate setting. Right? So Vagelos is not just a CEO who can make decisions. He has to report to a board of directors. He needs to get their approval before he does this. So how does he handle that? So now he thinks about this and says, you know what, let me go back in corporate history. Let me try and see what we did in the past that actually justifies this method that I'm going to use. And he goes back to post-World War II and what happened in Japan in post-World War II. And of course, we know that most of America was shocked by what happened with the dropping of the atom bombs. And so there was an American conscience that was actually on the upsurge post-World War II. And many companies did a lot of stuff in America, in Japan, in the reconstruction. Merck was one of them, and what Merck did was gave away tetramycin for free. Okay, so there was a lot of outbreak of disease there, and they went and gave away tetramycin for free. Now, at that time, this was a kind of a parallel. But what happened later is very interesting. 10 years later, Japan said no foreign companies will be allowed to bid for any government contract. But they made an exception, and that exception was Merck. They said, Merck can come and bid, and they won a multi-million dollar contract a few years later. So Vagelos used this history. He said, we don't know what's going to pan out in the future. But right now, this seems to be the thing that we need to do. That is, we need to go and give this away for free. And so Merck made that decision. It was a huge splash in New York Times, etc. They gave away the drug for free. Okay? So Merck gets... So using the same example, so now you can see that this ultimate solution is something that's relying on analytical intelligence, where you say, I've done this problem in the past, I've solved this problem in the past, can I bring back that solution instead of reinventing the wheel now? Okay. I'm going to give you some examples for the other kinds of intelligences. And since the applicability of intelligence is human, these examples are going to be drawn from across the world. So now we saw America, North America and Africa involved here. But I want to shift the focus to the Amazon forests of Brazil for operational intelligence. Now this is a woman that you wouldn't have heard of. And of course you won't recognize her also. She's a poor farmer. Shouldn't say poor. She's a farmer in Brazil, in the Amazon forest in Brazil. And her name is Rosario Costa Cabra. Now, if you think about Brazil, the first thing that comes to your mind, apart from the Amazon forest, is what's happening to them, right? Tremendous amounts of deforestation. And as a result, a lot of flooding that happens. So especially at the delta areas where the river Amazon is meeting the sea, a lot of every day with the tide, a lot of the salt water floods in and affects what used to be very good farms before. So now you can't grow anything. But what Rosario Costa Cabral did was she bought a 25-acre piece of land there. And in this river basin where you have so much salt water flooding, she became a leader by using what we call operational intelligence. So what did she do? For 2 years, she studied the flooding patterns. What time of the day does the water come in? How does it get affected by the months? Now, what about growth? Where can we plant this plant? So they have tapioca is called cassava there. So that's the staple food there. So at what level of flooding can cassava tolerate? What level of flooding can papaya tolerate? Can these grow in salt water? If I breed these and grow this, the hardy ones next year, is there genetic improvement? So she studied these for 2 years and she mastered how to grow crops that can't tolerate river flooding even once, leave alone twice a day. Right? You'll die at the first sight of salt water, but now she's growing them twice a day. And not only that, this is where her real thing comes in, that her farm grows rich papayas, cacao, and chili peppers, but she's actually exporting this know-how to all the other people in the community. That her study, she's taking it, and that's how she's become a leader by becoming an operation. So this is the current state of her farm. You can see how it is lush and verdant and so green where you actually had deforested land before. Fantastic exhibition of operational intelligence, primarily because she operated. So we want to classify. So one of the key things is that blanket statement that we use today is we need to be agile, but we are saying that agility is not one. We need to parse it. So there are five different kinds of agilities, and this is one example of an operational kind of agility. Now I'm going to give you an example of inventive agility. How many recognize this? It is a
Gutenberg.
Absolutely. It's a printing press. What's remarkable about this is that this was perhaps the only innovation that remained unchanged for almost 400 years. Till the invention of the steam engine, this press remained the way it was invented. That's very unusual for any invention. They automatically undergo a lot of change. But this was one of the inventions that withstood the tests of time for 400 years. Yeah. Now, the story is very interesting, right? I mean, how many of you know the story of Gutenberg's thing? Gutenberg used to work in a coin mint. Yeah. Where coin mint, what happens? There are stamps made on metal. So that was one kind of thing that he had in his mind. A second paradigm was that he was actually sitting in a church and watching the organ pipes go up and down. Right? So this huge church organ playing on a Sunday and the church organ pipes are going up and down gives him some ideas. So he puts these two ideas together and he says, okay, now this leads to the birth of the printing press. So now you can see that solutions that are working in the coin mint are being exported to the solution to form a new solution for printing. And of course, before the advent of the computer, the Gutenberg press is considered the most principal innovation that changed humankind in a lot of ways. The emergence of the printed book is actually a huge, huge change in the technology of mankind. A third one I want to give you, the fourth intelligence is about communicative intelligence. We all know Napoleon as being a great general. He was a great strategist. And I also told you that he was a great operational intelligence guy because he slept with his troops. He led from the front. But there's one particular thing that actually started marking his rise in the French army. This was 1793, and the French Revolution had just happened. And post that, there was some counter. So the French Revolution was followed by a bitter, you know, killing, right? So a lot of people were killed. And there was a certain sections of society that felt that the violence was just too much. And so they started reacting back. Now the French revolutionists wanted republic, wanted a republic. They didn't want the monarchy, right? So they were called the Republicans. Now the Republicans suddenly found themselves in a particular situation where a certain city called Toulon, very important port city, had rebelled against the French Revolution. And worse, they'd called the British in for help, and the British had come into Toulon, and now Toulon had become a British port, and Britain suddenly had the second largest port in France, all without war. Not one shot fired, given as a gift to Britain. So what do the French do? Quickly, the Republican army sends two different kinds of battalions from different aspects, from different sides of the ground, and they come and they lay a siege to Toulon. It's called the famous siege of Toulon, 1793. But siege fails. Why do sieges succeed? Sieges succeed because they starve a city of food and supplies. But here was a port city, and although the land side was blocked, happily supplies were coming in from the seaside. The British were bringing in food, reinforcements, everything. So the siege failed. So months together, the French were sitting out there, the British happily supplying stuff to the French citizens in Toulon, and everything hunky-dory, stalemate. So then comes Napoleon, very young French lieutenant, and he surveys the field, and he says, we need to shoot the British ships out of the water. And to do that, there's this position on the hill where we can put 6 guns. And he was an artillery guy, for those of you who know it. So he says, let's put 6 guns on this hill and we shoot that. And the French generals laugh at him and say, you know what, we've tried that. The British ships, it's not like you're sitting out there and happily shooting at the British ships. They have guns too. And especially when you sit on a hillside and you're putting your guns there, you're open to those people and they can shoot back at you. In fact, we've been shot back so badly that no soldier wants to volunteer for a position there. So Napoleon says, no, give me a chance, give me 6 guns, and I will get volunteers for this. And how does he get volunteers? He goes and gets his assistants to make a huge banner saying, I want men to volunteer for the battery of men without fear. That's the name he gives this battery. And overnight, many people are volunteering, many soldiers are volunteering. What happened here? He plays on something that's very important to a soldier's morale. A soldier is known and wants to die for being a brave man. So he, by saying, so my standing among my peer soldiers is enhanced if I'm seen as a brave guy. So by just giving this name, he was able to get volunteers. 6 guns were set up, the British were shot off, and within 2 weeks, the siege of Toulon was lifted. So this is a classic example of how you can use communicative intelligence to solve a problem. And the fifth and final one is what I want to give you is something called visionary intelligence, right? And this is a scene from Attenborough's Gandhi. Many of you might have seen this movie. If you haven't, you have to see it because it's a sea-changing, mind-changing movie, right? And the scene is this. This is post-Calcutta riots. Right? You know that after we had the partition, we had tremendous riots on both sides of the border. We know very well about the Pakistan stuff. The Pakistan border, Punjab-Pakistan border. We've kind of ignored and forgotten the Calcutta side. But Calcutta was really terribly affected post-partition. And there were tremendous killings between Hindus and Muslims. And in fact, Gandhi went there to do something called and worked something called the Miracle of Calcutta. The police had been called in, ineffective. The army had been called in. Curfews continued, the violence continued unabated, but then Gandhi went in. And the scene before this is that Gandhi has fasted for about 10 days now and is virtually dying. He's very weak. And Nehru makes this impassioned speech saying, what the hell are we doing as country? We're letting Gandhi die. We have to do something. So now suddenly there's a slow transformation in the people. And this scene begins, I'm not going to show you the clip, the scene begins with a bunch of people coming and laying down their arms, and Gandhi is lying like this on the bed, and they're dropping their arms. And they say, these are two arms. We promise that we won't fight anymore. So Gandhi is very weakly says, God be with you, and they start to leave. As they're leaving, if you recall the movie, there's Om Puri, who is actually like that scene, right? He rushes in. So this men part, and everybody is scared that this is a, like, looks very violent and angry. And he rushes in. Everybody is scared that he might do something to Gandhi. He throws a piece of chapati on Gandhi and says, eat. Eat, because I don't want to die with you. I don't want your death to be on my name. So Gandhi is also shocked. And he looks at him for a while. And suddenly that guy, I don't know what happens to him, he starts crying and breaks down and says a story, right? And he says, I killed a boy this high. I smashed his head against a wall. So Gandhi is also shocked. And he says, why did you do that? And then he says, they killed my son. And he breaks down, right? So as he's breaking down, there's a long pause, very, very long pause. And then Gandhi says, I know a way out of hell. Adopt a boy this high, a Muslim boy this high, and bring him up a Muslim. It's a tremendous kind of solution to this problem. Now, at the end of it, of course, the actor, Om Puri, the character that Om Puri acted, breaks down and is weeping at Gandhi's feet. But you think about it for a minute, right? What would we have done to repair this kind of damage that this person has inflicted on society by killing a boy, by smashing his head on the wall? Normal thing would be to put him in jail, maybe try him for capital punishment even and throw him, right? If not for capital punishment, at least for manslaughter or something like that. But would it have had any effect? This is where the visionary thing comes up from Gandhi's perspective. That in that long pause, there is a reconstruction of the events that might happen going forward. And he says that take this solution, because now several things happen. One is Muslim children, who are many of them who are orphaned, now one of them at least finds a home, right? Secondly, this person's own, we can see that he is actually suffering from remorse for having done it. Now we can find a way to actually help that person recover his own self in some ways. So there's lots of visionary stuff that happens. It's not something that can come to us naturally, very immediately, but we need to work on this. Okay? That's one of the key things. So how do we do this is a question. So now what I've given you is a set of scenarios where people have used one or more of the five intelligences to solve problems. Okay? Right from the broken cup story to thinking about Gandhi, who uses visionary intelligence. The thing is, how do we do this? Many assessments, we can actually go and assess ourselves in a formal methodology, or we can actually do some introspection. And that introspection or the formal methodology may lead us to this kind of formulation, saying that if I was perfect on all five intelligences, I'd have a perfect pentagon. But I'm not perfect. Actually, I solve a lot of problems with analytical intelligence. Right? So I try to analyze a lot of problems before I solve them. Maybe analysis is not necessary. Maybe I need to jump into action and do stuff. So this might be some kind of conclusion that I come to based on my assessment of this. So how do I do this, take this forward and say, how can I use this to practice leadership in everyday life? Practicing intelligence-driven everyday leadership follows what I call a MAST loop. MAST stands for four different actions. The mapping, so saying, in my kind of world, what kind of uncertainties will I come up against? Are there more of one kind versus another kind? Which means that do I have to be more operationally intelligent than analytically intelligent? Do I need to be more communicatively intelligent than inventively intelligent? So I lay out my map. So it can come out to be a kind of an imperfect pentagon. And then a second thing I do is I assess what intelligences we have. Do we have the appropriate set of intelligences that we need to cope with this particular world that I'm seeing? Okay. Third is, suppose I don't have those that intelligence makeup, how do I create a strategy around it? Do I build it or do I change my environment so that I don't encounter those and play only to my strengths? And the fourth one is, we don't think about this as being end. We actually say there's a testing that happens because we don't know if this will work and I might have to change my strategy. So I don't make a wholesale commitment. I make some plan and test it and retest it and test it and retest it. So I keep going back in this loop. And so the mapping, assessment, strategizing and testing happens all the time. So I'm going to close with two very interesting videos that are showing this in action and basically pushing to why we need to bring in more of a visionary intelligence into this. So here's a classic example, a homegrown Mumbai example of how operational intelligence works. And I'll let you watch the video because it's self-explanatory. Which one? This one? The light?
Yeah, we'll do it.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, you can play it.
I can play it.
Yeah,
if you visit Mumbai, you are bound to notice the dabbawalas. You may not realize this, but the dabbawalas are a very important part of life in Mumbai. They are the ones who make sure that nearly 200,000 people get their lunch inside at their offices or schools every day from home. Their operations are so efficient that world personalities like Prince Charles and Richard Branson have visited them. They have been invited for lectures at business schools. They are even said to be Six Sigma compliant. Now what is a dabba? A dabba is simply a tiffin box carrying home-cooked food, which is to be delivered from the home to a person in an office or a school. And the dabbawala is a person who picks up the food from the home and ensures that it is delivered to the right office, to the right person on time.
Namaskar, mera naam Raghunath Dhondeva Bhajiye hoon. Main dabbawala association ka president hoon. हमारी डब्बा का सर्विस आगरा से नंदे से शुरू है. हमारी टोटल 5,000 मेंबर मुंबई में कार्यरत है.
It always sounds fairly simple, but imagine doing this in one of the most densely populated cities in the world. The dabba walas have high rates of accuracy and their error rates are shockingly 1 in a million only. And what is even more impressive, that all the dabba walas are fairly illiterate and have no use of any technology. The only motorized transport used is a Mumbai local train. Other than that, they make use of hand-drawn cars and bicycles.
मेरी ग्रुप की साइकिल है अंधेरी स्टेशन में छोड़ के जाता हूँ तो मैं दूसरे ग्रुप की साइकिल डिलीवरी पॉइंट पे यूज करता हूँ और मेरी साइकिल वो लोग यूज करते हैं.
द डब्बास और द लंच बॉक्सेस हैव अ कलर कोडिंग स्कीम व्हिच मेक्स श्योर दैट दे गेट टू द राइट डेस्टिनेशन. द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ दिस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज फेयरली फ्लैट. इट हैज जस्ट 3 लेवल्स. फर्स्ट द गवर्निंग बॉडी, सेकेंड द टीम लीड और द सुपरवाइजर एंड थर्ड द डब्बा वाला. And everyone is an equal shareholder in this organization. There are no bosses and the earnings are equally divided.
Har ek banda ka kaam team ke liye karna hai. Agar ek banda kam kaam karega to puri team ki income source low ho jati hai.
All the dabbawalas come from the same Varkari sect. And whenever any replacement is required, villages that have this Varkari sect are approached for suitable candidates. To join this organization as a dabbawala, the dabbawalas have to bring a few things. A long wooden crate, 2 bicycles, and rupees 20 for a Gandhi cap that they wear. And how much do you think would it cost to avail of this very efficient dabba service? Less than $10 a month. While the operations are fairly simple, the dabbawalas are now beginning to work with newer technologies. over to their site mydabawala.com to avail of their services.
अभी लंदन में भी प्रिंट करके शादी में जाता हूँ. इटली में दो बार जाने का मौका हमें मिला है. और मैगजीन में भी हमारी रिसर्च की थी. बीबीसी ने भी डॉक्यूमेंट्री वहां बना के दी थी. हमारे ऊपर देखते हैं कि इनको क्यों ना सिक्स सिग्मा देना चाहिए. हमें तो पता ही नहीं सिक्स सिग्मा क्या है.
एंड गिवन देयर रीच इन मुंबई, माइक्रोसॉफ्ट हैज ऑल्सो पार्टनर्ड विद द डब्बावाला. द डब्बावाला डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड लीफलेट्स एंड मोर माइक्रोसॉफ्ट ब्रांडेड क्लोथ्स टू स्प्रेड अवेयरनेस ऑफ जेन्युइन विंडोज सॉफ्टवेयर टू देयर कस्टमर्स.
5,000 मुंबई के रहने वाले 4,00,000 टिकट के ट्रांजेक्शन पर डे लोकल ट्रेन से, साइकिल से और मैन पावर की वजह से कर रहे हैं.
I'm basically showing you Mumbai.
Okay. That's a fantastic illustration of operational intelligence. Now, how do you take this and build visionary intelligence into it? Yeah. So this is where I'm going to show you the next video. And watch this. This is a fantastic transformation of the same dabbawalas. So my challenge to you is to examine your actions and think about how can you actually go beyond yourself, go beyond the short term and think about the long term. Okay, so while solving a lot of the short term problems with intelligences, think also about the visionary intelligence that you can bring into your everyday actions. And one of the key things that I have found is just becoming aware, just becoming conscious of our actions goes a long, long way in actually thinking about how to solve these problems. So I'm now ready for questions. If there are any questions, yeah.
Thank you, Prasad.
Yeah, sure.
The subject of intelligence is a very complex subject.
Correct.
And I never knew it could be so simple after I heard you. It is takes very, very deep insight to make this complex subject, to put it into slots. And I'm sure all of us have a lot of questions to ask. And we can start from.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I'm Dr. Kartik here.
Yeah.
Well, if you go back to history,
yeah,
if Sri Gandhi was not permitted to have his way, and both had a chance, maybe in India and Pak would have been single country. So there, I feel whatever you told, theory has not really worked out well. Maybe may not be, but this is my view.
True. I mean, this is speculation. So I mean, it's very tough for us to answer speculative stuff. I mean, what would have happened if, what if questions are always there. You know? So there are always, for every road taken, there's hundreds of roads not taken. Right. So it's I think in terms of that, it's kind of futile to be looking back. And one of the key things that I push toward organizations is don't try to project the future on the basis of your past alone. That there is a lot of things that may happen in the future that is not like your past. Are you equipped then to handle things that may not be like your past? So hindsight, while being useful, don't make it a habit to drive looking in the rear view mirror. Right? So that is my mantra for this thing. So speculation, you know, we don't know how it would have worked out. So that's where I will leave it. That
old saying.
Yeah.
Those who don't see from history, learn from history.
Absolutely. I know
are
that.
Are condemned to repeat it.
Correct. So, no, that is, I'm not saying ignore history, but I say take it along with an adequate measure. And when you don't know how things will unfold, to make projections from that history is very difficult.
Okay,
now, I can talk about the history of that Gandhi did and how India moved forward from that, mm-hmm. but speculating about whether Bose would have done a better job is a history that we don't know. We're speculating about.
Okay, thank you. And then in your master loop, that loop what you mentioned.
Correct.
I think it's same as the cycle in PDCA cycle, which is told in parity control circles. Plan, do, check, act cycle.
Sorry, yes, I didn't get the question. Can you repeat it?
In your loop, what you mentioned,
correct.
Loop, I think it is same as the cycle, PDCA cycle, that control, the Japanese control.
There are many parallels to that. In fact,
and do check act cycle.
Yeah, so there is a parallel. There are many parallels. So that's why that's a very common paradigm. So, for instance, if you think about the Korean War, and one very interesting military strategy that emerged from that guy called John Boyd, who was perhaps the most successful American pilot in the Korean War, he formulated a loop called the OODA loop: observe, orient, decide, act. So you can see many of these kinds of loop parallels happening. But loop parallel is common to any feedback system that's trying to respond, right? So, yeah, there are different words, and the actions that I'm trying to do is somewhat more nebulous than you would have in a systems control kind of environment, where you have very corrective kind of measures. So if you go back to electrical engineering and talk about servo control mechanisms, etc., they're very specific actions, and like a thermostat switching on or off is a very specific action that it does based on what is. But here, there is a scope for different kinds of actions to creep in. And that's where the power of the MAST methodology comes.
You have understood what are the five intelligences that you're talking about.
Correct.
But how does one get to acquire these intelligences?
Correct.
How does one, is it something that one is born with? Is it, Gandhi never learned management, never Correct. Learned leadership skills. And he was probably the greatest leader that we had.
Correct.
But how do we create these leadership skills within us? Okay. Whether you are managing a business or
your life.
Or a country.
Absolutely. Very, very good question. Now, for this, I would trace back to the word why we named our company Vivekin. Okay. And the closest parallel to intelligence in the Indian language is Viveka. And actually, I should say the closest English translation of Viveka is intelligence, right? But Viveka is more than intelligence. Viveka has two big aspects to it. One is awareness. So when I'm sitting there and I'm looking at my options, if I'm not aware of all the options that are available to me, I won't make a good decision. That's first, being open to all kinds of options. Second, among these options, how do I use my discrimination? How do I use, say, which is the best among this? So in Sanskrit literature, you'll see the differentiation between milk and water as being one of the things that Viveka does. Yeah. So these kinds of things. So Viveka is where I would go. Now, when you come back to Gandhi and our own lives, becoming aware and also recognizing, making it a conscious practice to say which of these would be the best, that is the best way to develop the intelligence. There is a lot of debate in psychological research. Is intelligence nature or nurture? Right? And to a large extent, it was believed that it is genetic, that you were born to be intelligent. But what people found and scientists found through longitudinal studies, that is studies over several years, was when they worked with separated twins who would have perhaps the same genetic makeup, the environment made tremendous amount of difference. So the consensus today is that, yes, intelligence matters, but it's not the only thing that matters. So now you start to expand that. And so a lot of it is the cultivation. And going back to Gandhi was never born a strategist. He made tremendous mistakes. In fact, a lot of the stuff that he learned in was in South Africa that he did in India. Right? So the learning aspect is very, very important, which is why the intelligence. So if you think about, there are so many parallels here. If you think about artificial intelligence and you say, when do I declare a machine to be intelligent? The characteristic of an intelligent machine is that it learns. So we need to be able to say that our learning has to happen constantly. That we need to be more introspective, more reflective about what is happening and how things are evolving based on our decisions, and then we start to sort of find the pattern in our own lives. So your version of what might be visionary will be very different from my version, because your experience and your learning will be different from mine. But the key goal is to say, let's be more aware and conscious, and let's also pay more attention to how we are doing things. So, yeah. Sure.
Do you find the, suppose an intelligence in an animal species, do you find that these things at all can be slotted in these five intelligences? or is it very different, or how does it work?
No, actually I have a very interesting framework, a 2x2 matrix in the book, where I talk about the key thrust of the book is that first, intelligence is not one, it's multiple. So I link that to agilities. So a company can't be responsive in one kind of way, it has to be responsive in many kinds of ways. Second, you need to have context sensitivity. So in the 2x2 matrix, there is a certain class which has no agility and it doesn't have context sensitivity. So they're called dinosaurs. Okay? So the dinosaurs have tremendous amount of resource but no adaptability. So when weather or climatic changes happen, they don't adapt and they die. The other is a bear. The bear has a lot of resources but no agility. But it has one significant thing, that is context sensitivity. It knows when to operate and when not to operate. So in the winters, it goes away happily and hibernates and comes back when it's spring. So that's the second kind of thing. So bear has, you can call one kind of agility. Now the cheetah is a very interesting example. That's what would mark operational intelligence. It's a running machine. A cheetah is a running machine, designed, every muscle in it, every sinew in it is designed for it to run. But there are some strange facts about it. Cheetahs can't climb trees, they can't hunt at night, they can see only at day. So now what happens? And everything it tries to hunt, every way, every time it tries to hunt by outrunning its prey. So that's the only thing that it can do. So now you're stuck on one kind of agility, right? So operational intelligence can be seen in the cheetah. What our model of our organization is the human model. That's a classic model where you have both context sensitivity, which is a very, as an aside, that's a very Indian contribution to thinking, context sensitivity. Right from the Dharma Shastras, where the laws are not applied uniformly until we had the Hindu law made by the colonial regime. We had laws very contextually applied. Do you seat a guest? Do you not seat a guest? From that kind of detail, to how do you try a crime? You know, there is very contextual. So there is a lot of context sensitivity in Indian thinking. So that context sensitivity and the ability to have multiple agilities and use them in a context sensitive way, that's the human model. That's what we model for the organization. So when you talk about animals and intelligences, yes, they do have certain kinds of intelligences which we can slot here, but it's not the model for us. The model is actually the human.
Human.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Thank you very much, and also the one that you brought back and the conclusion with my favorite slide, the Dabbawala. Thank you very much and hats off to you. One question to adding to this one in the intelligence. Take it as the one and multiple intelligence.
Correct.
And also the one, the intelligent of the person with them, comparing with an illiterate intelligent. And you see that how this one, the looping is an exactly the one applicable to this Dabbawala, is an illegal, illiterate, the guy who is going in a particular office to deliver the Dabbawala in the time, every day. Okay. If he goes, comes and another one, if it is not there, the person who wants to deliver the one in time is not there. Uh-huh. That be the Dabbawala will be shared by other person. If the person is originally is not there, is an absent for the day. Uh-huh. In that, but the same, the Dabbawala will be shared by the other one, uh-huh, and delivered in time. That intelligence is that one the much, much stronger than this one, the particularly the person who is an intelligent guy. Can you be shared upon to this one?
Sure, I think you're making a comparison between intellectual ability and intelligence. So, for instance, educational training and intelligence. What we are trying to say is that there are certain conditions. As a human, the species has evolved. Evolutionary history has seen to it that we have these different intelligences. Whether I'm educated or not, doesn't matter. I have these five intelligences. Now, for instance, you might think of an illiterate person. Can he do analysis or not? He can. Can he shift between different kinds of analysis? Yes, absolutely. So, this is a very human characteristic. And the reason that we are pushing this as not being, coming from an educational perspective, not being from a social background, not being from any kind of genetic stuff, it's something that you can be conscious and develop. So that's the important takeaway from this.
Dr. Prasad.
Yes.
The intelligence levels, which we discussed on the five points, do you think implementation can be the sixth sense of intelligence?
Very interesting, but that comes under operational intelligence for us. So operational intelligence actually talks about action. So implementation is a kind of action for us.
So you mentioned the concept of collective leadership that we see a lot of, you said, in nature, birds.
Correct.
Can that apply to like the corporate world, or, you know, how, where can we see instances of that?
Absolutely. So if you look in the corporate world, you look at leadership training, leadership development, right? And that leadership development usually in the corporate world says you have to be above a certain rank in the organization. You have to be somewhere up in the hierarchy to be getting into that leadership development. And our argument is, today's turbulent world, you don't know who is going to be the leader. Now, when I say leader, don't mistake that to be the CEO. What we mean by leadership is the ability to take initiative, to make things that are going, to take action that goes beyond your specified set of duties. So, for instance, think of you calling, let's say, a telephone company to complain about your bill. The person who answers that, the customer service representative, at that time is the face of the company. So what he or she does, what kinds of initiative he or she takes, will affect how you will perceive the company and whether you will continue to be a customer of the company or not. So at that point, that person is the leader. So what happens is, we don't train the lower levels to think in terms of initiative taking. We don't think of them being any kind of decision makers. So there's a lot of talk in management about empowerment, and you know, how do you push the empowerment down the level, etc. But this is a, this is one of the things that we address.
In your view, what should have Nestle done in today's Maggie's fiasco?
I have a very interesting parallel in the book, which is, you know, I talk about Tylenol crisis. J&J, Johnson & Johnson, handled a similar crisis, and it was actually a life-threatening crisis. Those of you who know this case in management, in 1982, suddenly people were traced who took Tylenol were found to be dying in Chicago. Seven people died within the space of about 3-4 days. National crisis. I mean, Tylenol was, like Maggie, had the most market share. It had upward of 35% market share. Its sales were more than double the combined shares of the next 4 painkillers. There's a huge presence in the American market. But somebody, so what Tylenol did was, they went into a crisis mode. They got the CEO to participate in this whole thing. And it was not hiding behind any kind of PR firm. They didn't hire any PR firm. The CEO himself would appear on the TVs every day, give an update. The first thing they did was, they pulled off Tylenol from all the stores, not only in the capsule form, which was the problem, but in every other form, that was syrup, you know, everything. And then they constantly gave updates about what they were doing in their investigations internally. They said, we traced this back to, not just if you want to talk about a disgruntled employee doing something to a process. That's not true, because these shipments were made from different factories. So it's not a question of one employee taking it out, or a process failing in one particular thing. They traced it back to their quality control. Nothing was wrong. So they were very open and transparent, a classic demonstration of communicative intelligence. And the CEO was the face of the company. It was not a PR company. It was not a PR company that they had hired to do this. And the people actually felt that their side was being taken. And so slowly, the Tylenol recovered its market share to back to 30% at the end of 1 year. And they also did things like promoting by giving coupons at the end of this, making sure they made an announcement that how they were redesigning the bottles to be tamper-proof, how they were no longer going to sell the capsules which could be tampered with, but it was only going to come in tablet form. So all these kinds of measures that they made public, that was a classic way of handling a crisis, which is why I said the Maggie story is actually a communications crisis. It's not really a production crisis. It's a perception crisis. How do you handle that perception? If there is really something wrong, how would you redress that? Right. So that is the classic analog that I can think of.
It is often said that the total intelligence in this planet is constant, but population is growing.
This is like a panel in which a panelist leaves the panel and the entire average IQ of the panel goes up. Correct. Right?
Do you see any one of these five intelligences creating more impact than the other four as times go by?
Yeah. For me, if I had to choose the intelligence, it would be the visionary intelligence, because it is the kind of intelligence that we lack today. We have a tremendous ability to respond in a short time. And those of you who have done any kind of mathematics or graph theory will know that there are certain things called greedy algorithms which reach for the quickest solution. But in the long term, they're not the optimal solution. So how do you actually think about the long term and the wideness of your impact? You make a decision here. Let's say as a manager, you say you're going to bring some resources here. Now, how does it impact other parts of the organization? How does it impact other employees in the organization? These are issues that I'd like to us to think of. So the visionary for me is a very important thing to cultivate.
We have had two prime ministers of late, Manmohan Singh and Narendra Modi.
Correct.
Very contrasting personalities, very contrasting skills and abilities. Correct. How do you analyze them and distinguish them from a leadership point of view?
Absolutely. So now from this thing, voice vote here, but I venture to say that I know. So there is an issue here. So I think.
Add on to that question.
Okay, add on.
Manager, a student, or a sociologist, or an artist like Kusum, it's so beautiful. Like, you know, it. You read it, and it makes you think so much from your. From my visit to my heritage to Spencer, like from his sweater episode to courier in India.
Correct.
And it's mind-boggling. I think the best thing of the book is you just start thinking so much.
Glad to hear that. Yeah.
And, you know, I've been thinking. I am a homemaker, an alumni of University of Hyderabad, and a very good friend of. They have been my... You know, intellectual in my children's and my intellectual journey, they have been very much with me for the past, I don't know how many years. So there is thing, this Modi's visit to Northeast. And you see, no other prime minister visited Northeast. The moment Modi visited Northeast, there is a sudden visibility that appeared. And whether... What kind of political and, you know, strategic psyche it worked on the China.
Uh-huh.
That it, you know, what happened in Manipur and how Modi took a step forward. Like, how do we understand this? You know?
Yeah. So there is a combination. So to go back to the original question, you can think of Manmohan Singh, very transformative, right? Forget the 10 years of his PM. But as finance minister... No, leave alone. Not leave alone the 10 years. Okay. You know, you think back to the 1993 reform, which is actually responsible for the growth rates that we see in India today, right? So there was a tremendous kind of what I would call Manmohan Singh would be a tremendous analytically intelligent leader. Okay? Perhaps not so much operational. Where I would classify Modi is in two very, very strong, in two kinds of intelligences. Operational, so you can see him leading from the front. You know, you can see him as a man of action, but also communicate. A tremendous branding. If you see, nobody uses Twitter as much as him, right? He's there on Twitter all the time, he's everything. And I think the selfie has become a common thing because of Modi. So there are these things about... You know, there's a joke, I don't know if you've seen that. There's a thing with two mirrors. Modi taking a selfie, and Modi taking a selfie of himself taking a selfie, right? So, a tremendous branding effort. So, he's a classic communicative intelligence person. So, these are two things that stand out for me. The Manipur thing, I don't know how it will play out in the long term, but it did something dramatically in the short term. Now, we still have to wait for that judgment to roll by, whether it had a strategic impact or not. And that's what happens with many things that we do. We don't have that visionary capacity right now to be able to look into the future. But that's a very good move.